This will be the first in a series of videos on registers and counters. These videos will be in short clips allowing you to watch the videos at your own pace and will be part of a larger set of slides posted to the Canvas site. These videos have been presented during the live conferences that we've had in class, but this is available for those of you who may not be able to access class during the regular course time. So the first question to ask is, what is a register? Registers will be particularly important once we get into the microprocessors class this fall. Registers are the basis for almost everything that happens within a microprocessor, in terms of data being transferred from one area to another, in terms of holding computations, in terms of performing logical operations. So a register is a group of bits, and that group of bits can be set sequentially based upon things like the code that you have written. So as one line of code executes, it can change the value in a register. It can take a register's contents and copy it from one place to another. It can clear out a register. And that is done sequentially. So lines of code are executed one after the other after the other. And they can be changed based on both internal and external events. And so internal events might be the execution of code, other things that have happened internally. Maybe you have some kind of calculation, maybe you have some kind of logical operation that you've executed, and that is changing things. Or it could be based on external events. So perhaps somebody is typing something in on a keypad that your device is connected to. Perhaps something is sent to you over a network, or you're getting feedback over a USB connection from some peripheral that you are attached to. And so some examples of where registers may be used. Digital ports can be written to or read from. So if you're talking about various pins that can be used to, say, turn on and off lights, to send in and out data, those are written to or read from using registers. And so we can determine if a switch is pushed, we can determine if there's various data coming in saying from a printer that there is an error with the print cartridge or we're out of paper. All those kind of information are transferred through registers back to the digital system. And we can also look at the status of a sensor. So maybe you have a temperature controlling system, and so this thermostat is indicating it's too hot, we need to turn on the air conditioning, or it's too cold, we need to turn on the heat. Those kind of things can indicate sensor data, and those can be processed and put the value into a register, a digital representation of what's happening in the physical world. And as we already mentioned, it could change in response to code, but one of the fundamental things that a digital system does is it has to keep track of which line of code is being executed currently. And so one of the most important registers is what is known as the program counter. And the program counter simply keeps track of which line of code are you executing currently. Typically, that is done in sequence, one line, the next line, the next line, but sometimes in response to control statements like if statements or a switch statement or some kind of a go-to, you may change from one line to something further down, go back up. You may have a loop that is executing multiple times, and so you may be going through the same sequence of code, and then once the loop conditions are satisfied, then you can get on out of that loop. And so there are various ways that registers are used. And we can typically think about registers as being comprised of D flip-flops. Those are the most basic register building blocks. And those are convenient because we simply line up the data that we want to go into the register, and then after a clock event, that becomes the value in the register. And so we will have a common clock across all of the D flip-flops for a register. And in fact, all of the registers will use a common clock. And that way, when you're transferring from one register to another, you have the same synchronization from that one register that is receiving data and the register that is sending data. And so the Q output of the D flip-flop is what's holding the current value in the register, and the D input on the D flip-flop is what's setting up to accept the next value that you want on that register. So that can look something like this. And in this case, we have a 4-bit register, and so we are seeing these 4 bits come out here, and we are loading up the next value for the register. So currently, this register is outputting 0, 0, 0, 0. That's its current value, and we want to load in 1, 1, 0, 1. And so you'll notice over here, we have 2 inputs ANDed together, a load signal and a clock signal. And those are providing the clock. So we have a common clock. And why are we using a separate load signal? Well, what you'll notice is if you're not loading, if you have a 0 here for the load signal, you're always going to get a 0 out here on the AND gate. So that's never going to clock in a value unless you have indicated that you're ready to load a new value. When you are, then the clock can pass through. So notice this is a falling edge triggered device. So falling edges of the clock will trigger the transfer of data in. And so when we allow the clock to pass through, because the load line is set to 1, then when we're loading, we can pull that in. We also have over here, each of these flip-flops has a clear signal. And what that will do is reset the output to a 0. And you'll notice that this is active low as well. So that bubble indicates when the CLRN signal goes to 0, since we have CLRN driving all 4 of the clear signals, just like we have a common clock signal, that will clear out all 4 bits of our particular register. So we can load a new value and we can clear a value. Here is a different approach. What this does is it uses a D flip-flop that has another input, a CE input, which, depending upon what manufacturer you talk to, could be a chip enable or a clock enable. And what that allows you to do is when you want to load a new value, that is when the clock can actually have action. If you keep the load signal at 0, any clocks that are coming into these flip-flops are ignored. And so we have a common clock signal, and we have a load signal driving the CE input. The nice thing about this is it does eliminate the need for that AND gate that we had previously, but it does require some flip-flops that have this extra input. So not all flip-flops will have a CE input, but this is one particular type of flip-flop that does. And the CLR is behaving exactly the same way. So when you want to load something here, you assert or set to 1 the load line, put a 1 on each of the CEs simultaneously, and then before you've done that, you have set up all your data for the next output that you want, and then when that clock signal comes on through, then it's ready to transition what's knocking on the door at D to the output Q. So this represents some shorthand notation for those registers. This thick line with a slash through it indicates that there are 4 such D lines and 4 such Q lines, and they are driven by a common CLRN, a common load, and a common clock. So when you have a lot of redundant circuitry, a lot of those bits start to look exactly the same. This is just a shorthand way to say, hey, I've got a 4-bit register. Particularly when you're talking about modern day systems that have either 32 or 64 bits, you wouldn't want to have such a cumbersome circuit that shows all 64 of those connections, because that would just get to be too exhausting, pretty much too busy to really notice the details. When you have a lot of those redundancies, this tells the story. And so you can easily see all of those bits. So our next video will focus on how to transfer data from one register to the other. So I will stop right here at this point, and we will pause this video, and you can get ready to watch video number 2 on data transfer.